Hello AG Decoders, and welcome to another video. And today, as you will have seen from the title, we're going to be looking at the score. One of the problems with AGD that some people mention is that you can't test the score. That is to say, you can't, for example, give a player an extra life or a bonus. You can't trigger something happening if they reach a certain score, so there are no real targets. The reason for that is that the score is actually stored in 6 bytes as ASCII, and therefore it's difficult to be able to measure it numerically. So I had a think about this, and I came up with a little solution that will allow us to test the score, and I'll show you how we do that now. So the first thing we'll do is move over to a demo. And I'll show you just how it works in action. So let's move over to that now. And as you can see, here is the score. And when it hits 1,000, I'm triggering an explosion, just like that. So exactly at that point, when the score hits 1,000, I'm creating a test for that and causing that explosion. Obviously, you could use any kind of test that you want to. So here it is. And what I'm doing, as you can see here, I'm setting RAND to be 1, and we'll come back to that in a minute. I'm running this small assembly code, then I'm testing RAND again, and if RAND is equal to 0, I'm causing the explosion. So what I've got here is I've stored the number text-wise in the messages as a 6-figure number, if you like. It's actually 6 ASCII characters, but basically it's the same format that the score uses. So the reason why we do that, obviously, is it's the same format, so we can basically make a comparison much more easily without having to do a lot of conversion. So let's begin by looking at how we actually are able to run a test like this. Obviously, we're not dealing with numbers here, we're dealing with characters. But let's think about it in terms of these being separate numbers and how we can actually run a test that can determine whether one is equal or greater than or less than the other. So we've got 6 columns here. The first one is 100,000s. The second one is 10,000s, then thousands, then hundreds, then tens, and then just single numbers. So let's say, for example, then that we started off with these first 2 columns. And what I'll do is I'll put a 2 in here. And of course, if we check this, we can see 2 is bigger than 0. We don't need to check any of the other numbers because we know that 200,000 is more than no 100,000. And equally, if we were to put a 2 here, we would know that no 100,000 in the top is definitely less than 200,000. So as soon as we got to that point, we will know immediately which number is bigger or smaller. If the 2 are the same, then we need to move on to the tens of thousands, and then we need to move on to the thousands. So basically, in this example, we'll test the first 2, and they're both equal, and we'll keep moving down. If they're equal, we'll keep moving down. If there's a difference, that's our conclusion. So in this case, the hundreds of thousands are the same, but then the tens of thousands are the same. And in this case, as I've just changed it, these first 3 are all the same. But once we get to the hundreds, we can see that 900s is more than no hundreds, and so we know that the second number is bigger. And this is the basic principle that we use to determine and measure if 2 numbers are the same or different. And obviously, in this example, if we get to the single digits and they are equal, then our final conclusion would be that the numbers are equal, because obviously we're not using decimals here. Now, what's interesting about this is that these numbers, of course, are stored as ASCII, but the same principle applies, and that's why it's a good test, because we don't need to subtract anything, we don't need to convert the numbers into the characters into numbers. We can do the same test on the ASCII codes. As you can see here, 1049 is greater than 48, and that's our conclusion. And if I change that to a 1, then 49 is equal to 49, 57 is greater than 58. So exactly the same principle applies as long as we start from the left-hand side and go across to the right. And as soon as we find a difference in the numbers, then we know which number is either greater or less. And if we reach the end, we know that both numbers are the same. We'll just run through it one more time, just to be clear. As you can see here, 2,200, 1,900, equal, oh, difference. Top number is greater than bottom number, like that. Change it again. For example, let's change this one to a 3, and now the change that to a 0, for example. And let's say something like this, something a bit shorter. And again, same thing. First three numbers are equal. Hundreds are equal. Hundred thousands, ten thousands, thousands are equal. Ah, 200s, or and so on. Just the same principle. 50 is greater than 48. Is it just an offset? The numbers in ASCII are stored numerically, just the same as numbers are. And so that's the principle we're using. And here we can see again, 10, 4 is greater. So again, conclusion, very simple. And if the numbers are equal, then obviously we get to the end and we conclude that no change has happened, and therefore we know that the number is equal. So that's basically the principle, and we can now move over, have a look at the assembly code and look at how that's implemented so that we can run a test and basically give a number back to the user. So looking at the assembly code here, first of all, we need a few variables. The first one, as you can see, score. We're telling the code where the score is kept in memory. There is message pointer, which tells us where the messages begin. And then there is a routine, which is called getWord, and that's a built-in AGD routine, so we don't have to code it. And that basically takes the message number and tells us where in memory any particular message is stored, so we can find our message stored in variable rand, which we are also setting here at 32052. Now, it's important that we declare rand in the AGD code just before we run this code. We can't have any instructions between it because it will basically put the value in the accumulator for us. And I haven't loaded that value in here because it's automatic. And again, it saves us a byte, and it's always good to save bytes. So what does the code do? As you can see here, first of all, it gets the word and finds the address. That's the first two lines. Following this, we load BC with 1536. Now, that number may look unusual, but basically 1536 is 6 times 256. Now, B is storing numbers times 256, and C is the low byte. It stores regular numbers. So what we're doing is setting B to 0, 6 rather, setting B to 6, and we're setting C to 0. And again, it just saves us a bit of code rather than loading them separately. So we have B at 6 and we have C at 0, and we then load score into register DE to be checked. We then start by loading in the first value of the score and compare it with the first value of HL. If you remember in the previous part of the video where we were comparing each character one by one, we then check if it's smaller, and if it is smaller, we know that the whole number is smaller. And so therefore we jump down to the bottom where we will increase C. We then check if it is equal or not equal, I should say. NZ is not equal. So obviously if it's not equal and it's not smaller, then we know that it must be greater than. And so at that point we conclude it's greater than. We jump down to the bottom. And as you can see here, we've got num less than inc C, num greater than inc C, num equal than. And so, depending on where we jump to, if we jump to num less, C will be added twice. It'll be increased twice, so the value will be 2. If we jump to num greater than, 1 will be added, so the number will be 1. And if we jump to num equal to, then nothing will be added, and C will be 0. So therefore, we just have to load that value into rand. If rand is 0, it means the numbers are equal. If it's 1, it means the number is greater than the score, and if it's 2, it means it's less than. Now, the reason I've put them in that order is because the most common tests, apart from the individual less than, greater than, or equal to, the most common test we would want is if a score is greater than or equal to 1000. So in this example, what we're doing is we're setting rand to 1, and that means test message 1, which contains 1000. We run the code 20521613, which is where we've stored it, and rand will then be set to 0 if the score is equal to 1000. And as you can see here, that's exactly what happens. When the score is exactly equal to 1000, we get the signal which I've set here to be an explosion. However, this is problematic because what happens if the score doesn't hit exactly 1000? What if it just goes over 1000? For example, if I change this number here to say 13, we know that, 1000 isn't a multiple of 13. And so therefore, when the number goes to 1000, it never reaches exactly 1000, and so it's not triggered. So in actual fact, in this case, what we want to test is when the point at which the score goes over 1000, and we actually need to do two tests for that. We need to do one test before we add a score to make sure the score was less, and we need to do a second test after we add the score to test that the score is more, and that will tell us that adding this score basically caused it to switch from less than to more or equal to. So the first thing we do here is, as you can see, we're testing for the score, and rand will be stored here, and if it is less than, rand will be 2. We then add a score, and then we're testing if rand equals 2. So what we're asking is, before you added this score, was the score less than 1000? And if the answer to that question is yes, we'll then do a second test. So we'll then say, okay, so the score was less than 1000. Let's do another test now. And is it now greater than 1000? And that's where we've got here 2 greater than rand. And that's why we use the order that we did, because we're testing here for a 0 or a 1, which means equal or greater than. So in other words, in the whole test, we have, first of all, testing, is the score less than 1000? Yes, it is. And after you've added the score, is the score now greater than 1000? So we're looking for that transition point between 990 or to over 1000. And so that'll only happen that one time. Because if we only test for score greater than 1000, I'm sure you can imagine what would happen is that we would just get constant explosions, because of course, once the player gets to 1,000 points, the rest of his scores are going to be more than 1,000. So that's the reason why we have to test the transition, the change from less than to greater than or equal to. And that's why we have to run a test before we add the score and then another after. So with that in mind, I think what we'll do now is we'll move over and I'll show you a more practical example of this, because we don't want to have to do these tests every single time we add a particular score, because there could be lots of different events which cause the score to be increased. So we'll go over now and look at a more practical example of how we can apply this code to that. So what we have here then is my very first AGD game that I wrote, completed, let's say, which was this Space Invaders game. And what I've done here as a demo is basically set it up so as soon as I get 100 points, I get an extra man. And there you can see, if you watch again here, if you look down here, I'll just run that again, because that happened all rather quickly, didn't it? So go into the game here, keep an eye on the score there and the lives. As you can see here, the score is increasing, different points depending on different situations, which is what I was talking about. We have to do lots of different tests here depending on which invaders are hit. And so as soon as we hit that score, we're on 90 now, so keep an eye on the lives. Let's get another invader, and there you go, extra life. And obviously we don't want to keep adding extra lives, it just has to be that one time that it happens. So let's take a look then at the way that we achieve that. It's actually fairly simple. The first thing I do, of course, is I've set up a message here, and in this case it's message 19, because I've got all these other messages in there, so just need to make a mental note. Okay, 100, I can set that to any score I want. I could add extra messages if I want to do different tests, but for the purposes of this video, we're just going to use 100. So that's the first thing. Now, what we're going to have to do here is actually use an additional variable. And we're going to check the main loop. Now, what we know about AGD is the main loop one runs before the rest of the code, the rest of the events, and main loop two runs after. So what I'm doing here is I'm setting variable obj to 0, because I'm not using it anywhere else. You'd have to use another variable if you were. Then I'm sending ran to 19, that's the message. And then I'm running the test, and it says here, if the score is less than 100, obviously, which is in 19, then set object to be 1. So this is in the main loop, and this means that now we're now going to run through the player event, the invader events, and all of the other things, and then we're going to get to main loop 2. And so any score, if the score has changed, this is the point at which we would want to test it. So the first thing we do here is the same as the previous code. If obj is 1, that means if the score was less than 100, and then we test again, but it is now equal to or greater than 100. And as you can see here, I'm testing that by running the assembly and then using if 2 greater than rand, as we did in the previous example. And then there is an additional check as well, as you can see here, if 5 greater than lives, because I don't want the player to have more than 5 lives. And so if the player had 5 lives, they wouldn't get any more from getting a score at this point. And the final thing here, let d0, that's just something that I use. It's quite a nice trick. Basically, when d is set to 0, it means it sends a signal and to the main loop and tells it that it needs to update the lives and anything else that might need updating. So in this case, it's really just the lives or the score. And as soon as it sees that, so when I add a score or when a player loses a life, I just set D to 0, and then the main loop knows that it has to update the screen at that point, and it saves having to update in the code, and it saves having to constantly update, which obviously would affect the speed. So that's basically just a little bit of an efficiency thing, even though it does use up a useful variable perhaps. But in this game I didn't need to do that, so I was quite happy. Okay, so that's really basically the principle. That's how it works. It's fairly straightforward. Please, if you have any questions, you can put them to me on the Facebook page or indeed here. Remember to like and subscribe. It's always welcome. And I'm now going to get back and have a little game. I haven't played this for quite some time. And yeah, I do like a bit of spaces. Okay. Great, and now I've got 4 lives, so I can have a little bit of a longer game. So, yeah, that's it for the video. Hope you found it useful. Keep enjoying the Spectrum. Keep enjoying AGD. And, of course, as always, happy coding. Thanks a lot. Bye-bye.